In the last session, we trying to understand the linkages between economic activities and the environment. Today, I thought, as I mentioned at the end of the last session to you, that we will try to examine the relationship between the process of economic development and the environment. As you all know, that why is it important to look at the process of development? Because different countries are in different stages of development at various points in time. If you look at it during the First World War or Second World War, or you know, in the 1970s or today, stages of development at which different countries are in very different. So therefore, we have number of classifications. We say we classify some as you know, OECD countries, that is Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, which is sort of you know, synonym for developed countries. Or we call them group G7 or G8, the developed countries or advanced countries, capitalist economies. And several of these synonymous phrases we keep using. They are not really synonymous, but there are several of these phrases we use to term them. And on the other end of the spectrum, we have low income economies or poor developing economies, emerging economies. Then the concept of BRICS, etc. come. That is, BRICS stands for the first, the acronym, basically the first letters of five countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. Because why are these called as big group? Because this is the group of countries which seems to be comparable in terms of level of the levels of development, and they are on similar path in terms of rate of progress of the economy. They wanted to make the distinction because there are also countries in sub-Saharan Africa who are really struggling. So I always tell the students in the classroom that we can feel complacent about what you have achieved, but it all depends on with whom you compare. Or you feel, you know, really bad that no, you are not able to achieve what others have achieved, etc. It all depends on with whom you compare yourself with. So if you are going to compare yourself, the progress of your economy with respect to the economies of say Somalia or Ethiopia, you may feel complacent. But if you are going to be comparing with China, for instance, among the developing countries I am talking about, China or you know, Brazil, you may not feel very comfortable. See, that then there are all of this debate about why India is lagging behind China. Are we doing good in terms of environment or development? All these questions do really prop up. So what I wanted to say here is, so there are different countries in the world which are in different stages of development. And this is bound to happen. Historically, it has been happening, and also is bound to happen over a period of time. So there will be a degree of difference in terms of levels of development, levels of living, levels of per capita income in all these countries. In a typical development economics lecture, I will try to look at why are the countries at different stages of development, and you know, what can we do to sort of bridge the gap between them, etc. But this is going to be a discussion on environmental studies. So if you start this, you know, start this introduction to the students, they will also get motivated. They said, why I am studying environment? Not because Supreme Court makes me study it, but also because out of my interest. And what is the interest here is, see, basically different stages of development. So there are these differences between economies or between countries in levels of development is, you know, could largely be because of different approaches that they've adopted to achieve economic development. So approaches, in other words, I mean pathways. The roadmap for development is drawn by each of this country. Sometimes in consultation with each other, sometimes together through international forums, very often independently, because this has to take into account the local constraints, local resource conditions, local market conditions and the like. So therefore, they have to have different approaches to development. Sometimes we try to emulate others, we try to copy, we try to follow what others have done and see whether that can be suitable for us. Very often, several of the countries look upon India also. For instance, in the month of March, I attended a conclave in Bhuneshwar, where this was a sort of countries in the Indian Ocean. Well, I myself did not realize after, before attending that meet, and I was invited to give a talk there, when there are so many countries in Indian Ocean which all got represented there, looking forward to India's leadership in terms of furthering their own economy. Therefore, there are, you know, lessons that we can learn, and there are also the modification that we can make in our approaches to development. So given all this, our discussion in the forenoon first session today is going to be on saying how are different approaches to development do they have, first of all, do they have differential impact on the environment, or do they all are equally good or equally bad? And if they are, then can we correct our approach to development? So let me begin this discussion here on, you know, talking about, that's why I titled this approaches to development and its impact on the environment. So the basic question that we are going to ask here, only one question, are there any systematic association between approaches to development and the environmental conditions? Now the question is, you can ask me, why are you asking this question? There are reasons why I expect that they might be. I'm saying they're not, they will be, they might be. In view of the fact that approaches to development influences number of variables, number of factors, which in turn can influence environmental conditions. That is why, you know, it makes us, it may not have a direct impact, it may have an impact via media through these variables. What are they? How exactly this takes place, etc. Before I come to what exactly the approaches to development are, we will talk about it. But, you know, differential approach or any approach to development affect by and large the following factors. I am just giving an example of some, it is not completely exhaustive. Firstly, it tries to alter the structure of domestic production. What do you mean by structure of domestic production? That is, you say whether the economy is by and large characterized by primary sector, secondary or tertiary in the traditional sense. Now we call it agriculture, industry or services, and within the industry we talk about whether manufacturing or non-manufacturing. What is the structure of domestic? It does alter the structure of domestic production. We gave a fillip to IT sector. IT sector is one of the fastest growing sectors in the economy for more than a decade now. It was. In the 1980s, we gave fillip to microelectronic based industries, biotechnology based industries. So they were leaders. But if you look at it historically from 1950s till now, although we did not give much of emphasis, the fastest growing sector has been the services sector. So approaches to development, it tends to affect the structure of domestic production. So which in turn is likely to affect the environment? We will see that in a while. So first let us understand how the approach of development, what all it does it affect. Secondly, approaches to development also affects the nature of the binding, most binding constraints face the economy. So for every economy, there are constraints. The hurdles, why they are not able to grow fast, why they are not able to achieve the levels of living or income levels of say the advanced countries. So there are number of constraints that they face. So approach, the way we draw upon the roadmap for development or approach to development is basically to remove these constraints so that we are placed on sustainable growth path in terms of consistently we will be able to grow at a high rate. So it also affects the, it also is expected to change the, remove or alter the most binding constraints facing the economy. Let me give you two examples. If you look at India in 1950s, the foremost constraint that people talked about at the time was absence of technology or technical know-how, and also absence of capital, both physical capital goods as well as financial capital. While financial capital can be brought from elsewhere, what about physical capital goods as well as the technology? So the planners were thinking whether we should depend on imports for them. So then the question is, should we just import once and then sort of remix in India? I mean, they adopt it in India so that we become, you know, we can be innovative on that, a la Japan, what they did, import and adapt technology. Or what exactly are the ways through which you can do? Can we just encourage domestic R&D effort? Now, all these are number of things, steps through which you can do. Thirdly, I mean, you also will have to see how do we encourage people to save so that we have enough investable resources for the economy. And finally, most importantly, the infrastructure. Infrastructure cannot be made elsewhere and imported here. You have to make it here. All the infrastructure facilities have to be made here locally. You can bring gas and, you know, others through pipeline, but you can't bring infrastructure, roads and dams from elsewhere. You have to make them here. So therefore, the nature of the most binding, it depends on how much government is ready to invest in all this, it changes the constraints. Thirdly, the technological and investment choices. So in macroeconomics, we have a concept of what is called crowding in or crowding out effect, effort. Now, when the government invests in certain sectors, we expect the private sector also to invest in those sectors. That means crowding in effect. Wherever the government invests, the private sector also goes and invests so that it augments to the growth of that sector. Sometimes when government invests, private sector may say government is already investing so much money, so I may not have a role to play, therefore I stay away from that. It's called crowding out effect. The idea here is the technological investment choices of the economy is by and large you know, governed or triggered by government intervention, government policies. So, what kind of technological and investment choices are we making? Let me give again an example. Amartya Sen wrote this book called Choice of Techniques, where he talked about should we use labor intensive method of production or should we encourage capital intensive method of production. In a country with abundant supply of labor, what Arthur Lewis called it, economic development with unlimited supplies of labor, one can always use labor intensive technology. Should we really embark upon capital intensive technology? So, choice of technology is very important. Again, choice of investment, are we going to invest more in baking bread or invest in factories which are going to turn out more textiles or guns. So, therefore, technological investment choices are extremely important in terms of approaches to development also. Fourthly, in order for the development to take place, we create number of institutions, institutional structures. In the 1950s in India, we had Industrial Licensing Act. In 1969, we came with the MRTP Act, which is Monopolies Restrictive Trade Practices Act. In 1973, we came up with FERA, Foreign Exchange Regulation Act. All of them have been modified now after 1991. The kind of institutions that were built at the time. Now, the role of institution is to sort of regulate and not monitor. Earlier, the situation was to monitor, dictate terms to industry, what to do, what not to do, etc. What is allowed, what is not allowed, etc. Now, the role of SEBI or Insurance Regulatory Authority or Telephone Regulatory Authority, they are all regulation. They will give freedom to the enterprises to do what they want, but they will only be a watchdog. They will look at what exactly they are doing. If need be, they will interfere because they cannot become anti-competitive and several of these practices. So, institutional structures also keep changing with different approaches to develop. Fifthly, approaches development also affects the income distribution. That is very important. Not everybody thinks that economies will simply follow what Simon Kuznets said based on a study of 100 years data of the US economy, which says that income disparity will widen as the economy progresses in the initial phase, but beyond certain threshold, the inequality in income between people will start declining for a variety of reasons. Now, environmental economies have now started establishing whether same inverted U-shaped curve holds true for in terms of relationship between economic development and environment also. So, income distribution, economic approaches development will also affect income distribution, whether it is going to increase the disparity between haves and have nots or is going to reduce the disparity between rich and poor. That is something also we need to keep in mind. And finally, in this sort of point that I made, it is not exhaustive as I said, some examples only, it will also affect the domestic relative to international prices. Let me give an example of people, especially those who drink coffee. I can't survive without drinking a cup of coffee in the morning. That's why I thought I'll give that example. Domestic relative to international price. When the coffee market in India was highly regulated, domestic, no export, coffee growers are not allowed to export, mostly confined to domestic sales only. So, demand supply, if there is a mismatch, we will import. Coffee prices were under check. Now, when our industries, garment manufacturers, textile manufacturers are all allowed to earn foreign exchange, software developers are also earn foreign exchange. The coffee growers ask, why don't you allow us also earn foreign exchange? So, government says, yes, we have to allow them. So, when they were allowed to freely export. When they started exporting, obviously, they were getting better price than what the price they were getting in the domestic market. As a result, the prices of coffee sold in India went up. So, the gap between domestic and international price that existed before we opened up coffee, allowed coffee to be exported, and today, the gap today are very different. Gap has narrowed. There is a huge gap between international and domestic price before, regulated price here for the domestic market, etc. Now, they are sort of getting closer. So, it will also affect the domestic relative to international. I am not here to say whether it is good or bad. So, we are basically saying these are the factors that can all change with differential approach to development. Okay, having said this now, therefore, we will try to see what impact it can have on the environment in a while. So, these variables that we just talked about in the previous slide, in terms of income inequality, in terms of international prices, investment choice, technology choice, etc. All these variables affect two important factors, among many others. So, I am only going to talk about these two today. One is the energy consumption, which is relevant from the environment point of view, and secondly, the pattern of land use in the agriculture system. So, these two, when they are affected, how exactly they are affecting, we will come to it in a while. We need to establish how they are affecting these two. They will also affect several others. So, these two, you know, when they are affected, in turn affect the extent of environmental degradation. Because these are crucial factors, land use pattern, land use, you know, in agriculture, and the energy consumption pattern. These two are crucial factors that will have a big say on the environmental degradation. Whether environmental degradation will take faster, slower, sooner or later, etcetera, all this depend on this. That is why it is important to understand the development strategy. So, if you are able to therefore identify which approach is going to be environmentally more benign than the others, then accordingly you can make your choice. So, that is why, as I said right at the beginning, late starters in development can look at it as sort of an advantage rather than a curse. So, because developed countries may not be able to reverse some of the adverse effect that they already have faced, but now they are definitely changed their eczema. Okay, before I get into environment, so environmental damage by and large in developing countries, which is of information to you. But before I do that, I also want to tell you one other important aspect. I guess most of you would be reading newspapers. In the last 15 years, from the year 2000 onwards, you have seen, you know, multinational companies emerging out of developing countries. Before that, we only know multinational companies coming from developed countries to developing countries. Earlier, they used to export from their location to developing countries, seeking for more and more market so that they can expand. But then they thought best is, why don't we go and use the resources available there, produce it there and sell it there itself. So, among all this, you know, countries that invited multinationals, why did they invite multinationals? Now, we are also saying invite multinationals. Invite multinationals because they are going to bring in the investment. Why do you need more investment? Then only economy can grow at faster rate. Now, we need investment also because in macroeconomics, we have what is called the savings investment constraint. That is, if you want economy to grow at say 5%, 8%, you have to, your planners will tell you what is the proportion of GDP that you need to invest depending upon the capital output ratio. So, if you assume capital output ratio to be 4:1, simple macroeconomic identity that we assumed, Indian planners assumed in 1950s and 60s. So, if you want 5% growth rate of your GDP, you need to invest 20% of your GDP. 5% per annum growth rate of your GDP, you need to invest 20% of your GDP. Now, the question is, do you have so much of savings in the economy? Because savings is equal to investment. You can only invest what you, the economy has saved. And if the savings are less than the investment targets, then you need to bring money from capital from abroad. So, the investment targets in number of these countries are 35% to 40%, and in fact, if you look at Japan, South Korea, etcetera, in their growth phase, that is between late 1960s and 1980s, they all have invested 40% of the GDP, and the economic savings rate also reached about 40% over a period of time. So, but until you reach that savings rate, you need to bring capital from abroad. So, when you bring capital from abroad, there are strings attached to that. Definitely, there are conditionality. There are no free lunches. Nobody comes here to do charity. They come here to do business. They want to make money. Now, when they come here to make, you know, invest, produce, give employment opportunities to people, make money, all fine. So, we are not going to debate about multinationals are good, bad. That is a different debate altogether. So, but developing countries, economies, the enterprises have also started investing in other countries. You would have heard about Tata acquiring Chorus, several Infosys acquiring number of software developing countries, software companies in other countries. Several of these investments have been taking place. You know, Indian companies going and investing overseas. Even small and medium enterprises from Ludhiana, Tirupur, etcetera, have started setting up plants elsewhere or whatever they say because of, you know, better policy environment there than here, because they said policy paralysis and several of these factors. We are not getting into that also. Chinese, so did the Chinese companies. But you know, in that I wrote in 2000, I was trying to compare between Indian enterprises and Chinese enterprises which have gone overseas. And we found in the case of China that much of the overseas investments have been in oil exploring companies in sub-Saharan Africa. Crude oil, which they started to bring in back to China. All that is fine. So, they said it is like the old colonial model where you invest in resource sector, bring the resource for your development. But in the process of using, starting using the crude oil now, if you have seen recently, the outdoor air pollution in China has gone several times. Now, people are saying it's because of the poor quality of oil that they are getting from this African countries. They only went and invested, explored the oil and then bringing it back to their country. And then they say it's quality, and then they have to invest huge amount in order to clean that oil to be made use, say for example, reduce the sulfur content in diesel and several of these factors. So, your outward investment, bringing in resources for your development, imagine getting oil at cheap price because your own company. But it has adverse environmental consequences where it is used, where your own country. So, one has to be careful about all these aspects as well. So, that is one example I thought I will tell you since you might have read about this in the newspaper. Now, they are debating, is it the right wise decision to have invested in oil exploration in those countries? What do we do? Or should we explore and then sell it to other countries rather than bring it back to China? So, that is an example I thought you should keep in mind. Again, outward investment, opening up of the economy, allowing your companies to go abroad, invest overseas, approaches to development can also be harmful to your country if you do it the China model, especially with respect to oil exploration. Okay, now coming back, when we talk about environmental damage, we see a large difference, possibly, one is not very sure, therefore, it is a debatable point between developed and developing countries. But again, we are not getting into that, we'll only talk about it briefly in a while, in each of these aspects. But environmental damage, when you talk about in developing countries, by and large restricted to four factors: air and atmospheric pollution, water pollution and depletion, declining water table especially, land degradation, soil erosion, desertification and also deforestation. Each of it will have adverse development consequences because they also threaten the fundamental basis of your development itself. Okay, so let us look at each of these aspects now, especially from a developing country point of view. Now, the scientific and technical base of this, I am not going to get into debate with you because most of you are already aware of this. I am going to give you an economist's perspective on each of these environmental factors in developing countries, especially from a development perspective. Now, what we definitely know is the energy generation and energy utilization emit hydrocarbons, nitrogen oxide, sulfur dioxide and ozone into the layer. As I said, you know, all of you are familiar with this. Places where energy producing and energy consuming activities are concentrated, where they are located, the concentration of this pollutant is also very high. So, which means we have to deal with that particular area first and then the area where it is consumed or used. Now, what is unique about developing countries here? In developing countries, what happens is there are multiple kinds of problems. The air pollution is aggravated by the use of energy inefficient technologies because your productivity of the energy manufacturing sector, energy generating sector is very low. So, energy inefficient technologies with inferior pollution control and by the use of cheaper, high sulfur content, low quality coal and fuel oil, especially for heating and transport. An example here is, you know, they talk about quality of Indian coal and quality of coal that is imported from other countries, Australia, etc. Quality of fuel oil, sulfur content in diesel, for example. There is always an argument between the petroleum ministry and the environment ministry in New Delhi, especially in this. There are countries like Netherlands where there is a coordination between three ministries that tackle it. Environment ministry, industry ministry and oil ministry come together to discuss this. Here mostly what happens in India is the right hand does not know what the left hand is doing. So, each one operate as if they are autonomous or independent. So, sometimes the policies can be contradictory. I will give you some examples where I have been part of some of the discussions there and then I pointed out that they are contradicting each other instead of complementing each other. So, it is an important issue in especially with respect to energy generation and production. Some studies have shown that of the 18 cities which are worst polluted in the world, you find only 3 are in developed countries. Average daily emission of SO2 exceed the WHO safety daily mean standard in over 50% of the developing country cities. So, even on good days, Beijing, Tehran and Rio have mean daily concentrations of SO2 about 2.5 times the WHO standard. And these are not the developed countries. And what is also happening if you look at it historically, while developed countries cities are improving, those of developing countries are actually deteriorating, especially in most urban centers. What is the reason for it? Unplanned urbanization. Now, we are thinking in terms of smart cities. Are we talking about environmentally smart cities or we are talking in terms of, you know, smart quote unquote in terms of the looks and other facilities, etc. Pressure of development, urban concentration, nobody can understand it better than us who are living in a large urban agglomerate like Mumbai. Pressure of development, urban concentration are all issues here, which is true in most other places also in India. Unplanned urbanization is the most important cause of all this. But is it a problem only in urban areas? Is it a problem less in rural areas? Not at all. When it comes to rural air pollution, particulate matters like organic matter and various oxides results seasonally from burning grasslands and from the forest clearing activities for cultivation and grazing, etc., which is very common in sub-Saharan region, sub-Saharan African region. And also there are very, very serious issues of indoor concentration of carbon monoxide, particulates and hydrocarbons in households without proper ventilation. A study by a colleague, about 7-8 years back by Professor Rashmi Patil from Center for Environmental Science and Engineering, IIT Bombay, showed that improperly ventilated kitchen in rural areas, and where exactly they use the firewoods rather for fire to cook, the amount of pollution inhaled by the person who cooks, mostly it is women who cook in these places, is equivalent to the adverse effect of that on the health is equivalent to smoking 20 packets of cigarettes a day. That is the magnitude of pollution they are inhaling because of poor ventilation. Now there are projects on smokeless chulas which are given in a number of households in India. People are talking about solar, but before the smokeless chulas came. So the MIT has a poverty lab, and two colleagues from there are doing a lot of research on what happens to people when we give, especially from the poverty point of view, they are trying to look at it. Especially they have chosen the most poor people, poor households in Orissa, and the project is called smokeless chulas. They distributed smokeless chulas and tried to see the impact of it in T+1, T+2, T+3 years, etc., using experimental economics approach, and found substantial improvement in the quality. In fact, the health conditions are much better now than what it used to be before smokeless chulas. So the rural air pollution situation, not outside but inside the house, inside especially kitchen and other areas, it's also cause for concern in number of countries, including in India. I just made an attempt to give you some data of the pattern of use of commercial energy. If you look at developed countries and emerging economies means which are fastest growing, which includes, I put Brazil is an exception, that is why I put that there, which is sort of closing to this. 40% of the commercial energy used for industry, 30 for commercial residential use, that is service sector and others, and 20 for the transportation sector. Now see the last row. In poorest developing countries, 75% of the commercial energy is used for transportation. So which is not going to add so much to development in terms of GDP, but adding more to pollution. What kind of industries that grow that are given fillip and importance in these economies? So we know that most polluting industries are already listed by several studies, including by Government of India. Fertilizer, cement, paper and pulp, chemical, metal industries, petroleum, mining are heavy energy users. And in these industries, energy accounts for about half of the total intermediate cost. Now it's the uneven use of energy across sector which makes the main link between development strategy there. So if you are emphasizing more and more on these industries for your development, to be leaders of your development, to lead it from the front, obviously you will have the heavy energy users, adverse energy impact, environmental impact. If you are emphasizing on other industries which are less energy intensive, it could have a favorable environmental impact. So therefore, that's the kind of link that you can possibly have. But how can everybody follow the same strategy? That's a big question. Now let's move on to water. Two kinds of issues, one is pollution, other one is depletion. Two major water related problems are there, contamination and depletion. And surface and groundwater are being contaminated by agriculture, industrial, urban, human waste. Safe drinking water and sanitation are a major urban environmental problem. Not that they are not a problem in rural areas, they are a problem in rural areas also, because it is worse in rural. Between 25% and 75% of rural population, because vary from different countries, in different developing countries, do not have access to safe drinking water. Because sanitation, that is why now we are talking in terms of building toilets in all the households in rural areas after 60 years of planned development. And the results are chronic diseases, microbic infection, aggravated malnutrition, increased infant mortality, shortened life expectancy, etc. What happens in developing countries is nearly 73% of the water is used for irrigated agriculture, 21% for industry and only 6% for domestic. And developing countries account for 75% of the world's irrigated land area, require about twice as much water per acre as do the developed countries. And irrigation is increasing most rapidly in these countries in order to intensify the agriculture cultivation, etc. On top of it, there is a problem of land degradation, soil erosion and desertification. Cultivable land is the basis of livelihood of 80% of population. In India, we have more than 60% still dependent on agriculture for their survival, livelihood. Extremely rapid population growth leads to unsound agriculture practices, whose results are land degradation, land erosion, desertification, etc., which all need to be tackled. Because more and more demand, so you have to bring in more and more land under cultivation. What is the magnitude of the problem? Soil erosion through the loss of topsoil, that is either washed away or blown off the land effects, over one-third of the world's total rain-fed croplands. Estimates of extent of desertification, the extreme end of the gradual process of loss of soil fertility and soil erosion vary very substantially. And according to United Nations Environmental Programme, 2/5 of Africa's non-desert areas, 1/3 of Asia's and 1/5 of Latin America's are the risk of desertification. Therefore, one need to be worried about this aspect. Why am I talking about all this? Isn't this already in public domain? Where is the development economics coming into being? It is coming into being because who is affected? It is the world's poor who are most seriously affected. Why? Because they depend on the most marginal lands for their livelihood. So, if you say, this is a trade-off, if you say, look, you should not cultivate these lands because they are not environmentally good, it is not environmentally good to cultivate them, then their livelihood will go for a toss. Population pressure, agriculture practice, poverty, price policies and economic institutions interact to produce the devastating effect in mutually reinforcing cycle. So, there is a trade-off that we need to have development and then take care of the poor, or the development should only cater to the certain income groups. So, in most of these cases, we see how exactly the poor are affected. This is exactly how poor are affected the most. Then you will ask me, how do you know it's poor are affected most? Let me give you a typology. Increase in population density, poverty, already existing poverty exists, lack of alternative income earning opportunities and land degradation leads to reducing fallow time below the time required for natural restoration of soil nutrients. This interacts with the use of biomass for fuel to reduce soil fertility, and attempts to respond to reduce yield by clearing more marginal lands for cultivation that are highly erodible leads to further land erosion and greater loss of land productivity. That's exactly how it affects. And clearing of land coupled with shorter fallow periods also results in deforestation, and deforestation increases water runoff and leads to situation flooding in downstream areas, therefore widening the gap, widening and reinforcing the cycle of environmental degradation and poverty. Already people are affected, poor people are affected, now it exacerbates its effect on poverty. That is why even there is torrential rainfall or flooding or extreme drought, the poor are the most affected people. So, you need to have direct policy measures to take care of them. Not saying the others are not affected, but they are, they hit the most. So, typically what happens here is loss of productivity of land and soil erosion leads to further impoverishment and set in motion technological and institutional changes which reinforce the other negative trends of agroecology. And now with commercialization of agriculture, monoculture replaces traditional mixed cropping pattern that were necessary for soil fertility, and therefore problems of more intensive agriculture has sort of come up now. Now, we are also doing some study on the impact of climate change on land use pattern. So, some of these insights are coming from there. On top of it, if you see, land reforms in India continue to remain a paper tiger for several decades. The land tenure pattern changed due to agricultural intensification and commercialization, one of the reasons why farmers are driven to suicide. Nobody wants to talk about land tenure pattern. Enclosure of commons and loss of free access to gathering of biomass fuels, very important factor, adversely affects the rural households. Tenural changes lead to greater rural inequality and intensify both absolute as well as relative poverty. So, as doctors normally say, prevention is better than cure. How do we prevent? Being late starters, we can think of doing something about all this. So, prevention requires an integrated approach to development along with poverty and the environment. It is hard to design. It's not easy, easier said than done. It's hard to design and more expensive no doubt, than a simple integrated rural development program. Perhaps that's the reason why many countries have not yet embarked on this path. But it's high time they think about how to do it. One such way in which we have tried to given a recommendation to the government, I thought in between I'll also try to study about what research we have done, is there's a joint study that I undertook in collaboration with Indian Institute of Science Bangalore and Jadavpur University in Calcutta, where we tried to assess the impact of NREGA, National Rural Employment Guarantee Program. We took a particular district in Karnataka called Chitradurg, and then explained how, it was already a published paper in Economic and Political Weekly, we demonstrated how using NREGA schemes in the rural areas, we can build ecosystem services. Because by definition, of the act passed by parliament, NREGA is not supposed to create any physical assets like buildings, etc. So it can have sort of check dam, but without the concrete walls. So it can have other rural works program, and you have to use unskilled labor only. There are some of the conditions. So with using this, we said how you can build ecosystem services in rural areas. You can improve the biodiversity in that area, preserve or improve, which in turn can help you address the problem of climate change, environmental hazards. Now we were invited, when we prepared this report, we were invited to make a presentation to the government. We said all this is possible. So the idea is being considered now for implementation. Let's hope what exactly it can be done, because it doesn't contradict the provisions in the act, and at the same time your employment generation will go on, and what you're going to develop is ecosystem services which will sort of help the local region maintain the ecological balance. So this is an attempt, like prevention is better than cure. It may also address some of the deforestation issues, because deforestation in the sense of unsustainable tree clearing interacts with land degradation in a mutually reinforcing sense. And 2/3 of LDC less developing countries, tropical forests are Brazil, Indonesia and Zaire. Number of reasons for deforestation: evolution of agriculture systems, development of particular sectors like livestock, logging, hydroelectric projects, industrial fuel wood consumption, increase in accessibility and human and natural calamities like war, forest fires and the like. All cause deforestation. What happens with deforestation is soil erosion, flooding and desertification. Again, I am not getting into the details of it, since you are already aware of the scientific and technical input into this. But again, coming back to the point from a development economics point of view, the poorer are the hardest hit, because they live on the most marginal soils in the area that are most prone to runoffs and flooding, and prefer to rely on gathered wood for cooking. In one of the studies in the eastern coast of India, especially in the district of Kendrapara in Orissa, we have shown to the government how the problem of energy poverty exacerbates other poverty among the poor households, BPL population, when there is a climate related or climate induced extreme event like flood. There is a new concept called energy poverty which is coming to being, that because the whole world is talking about energy conservation, but here we are talking about not having had access to energy, and now they are also this term called energy poverty, those who don't have any minimum consumption of energy standard on a per day basis. We'll have adverse global effects of this. Loss of tropical forests leads to global effects like species extinction, emission of greenhouse gases, etc. And loss of species, entire loss of genetic material important to medicine. Now about 1/4 of the prescription drugs in the US are based on chemicals derived from plants in tropical forests. How much of our plants are being used for medicinal purposes, maybe already is information to you. We are also exporting a lot of medicinal plants. And loss of species diversity is also important to agriculture, since it provides enzymes for engineering plants with particular traits. So globally, deforestation also leads to emission of greenhouse gases by releasing CO2 into the atmosphere, both immediately and through subsequent burning or decomposition. So how do we manage this? With proper forest management. Forests are renewable resources, and temperate forest deforestation is a reversible process also. However, many of the adverse immediate effects of unsustainable deforestation may not be readily reversible. Therefore, we have to take care. So we could have policy intervention with respect to each of these. What we are trying to say is all patterns of economic development lead to environmental damage, and accelerated development leads to most rapid increase in environmental degradation. That's the first question that is asked. When government says you must invest more money, pump in more money into the economy to put the economy on the fast growth path. immediately people say, what will be the effect on environment today? We did not think about it in 1950s and 60s, but today we cannot say we are not aware. And therefore, what we are saying is all environmental effects are amenable to policy influence at the margin, because most economic decisions are at the margin, not in absolute terms. We can sort of shift. This is not to say economic development is unimportant, or there is a trade-off between economic development and environment, therefore don't develop. Nobody can say that. Development will have to definitely take place, but keeping in mind the environmental regulation. So, what are the options available to you? So, the environment policy or policy towards environment is expected to combat two aspects. So today, you cannot say everything will be dictated by the state. In 1950s and 60s, we tried, nobody will listen to you now. We are a market-based economy, like several other countries. There is no country in the world that you can say completely, you know, state-controlled economy. No one, including China. State does play an active role. The state here refers to government, plays an active role. Let's take the example of Malaysia and Singapore. The government plays a very important role, although they are also market driven. In US again, government plays a very important role. In Japan, South Korea, in all these countries, government played a very important role. But government will have to sort of understand how the market functions and influence the economic actors through the market only. Because in the market, most of the investors will look at it from short-term self-interest. If they are not, then they are not rational human beings. They have to look at it from that point of view only. Because nobody is doing business for charity. They may make money from business and use it for corporate social responsibility. But you cannot say your business itself should be for charity. Nobody will invest. So you have to combat between the invisible hand, that is influencing the market forces, the phrase given by Adam Smith, invisible hand, for the market forces, market economies, and the short-term self-interest of those who benefit from resource mining policies. So therefore, and you have to educate them make them appreciate the need for longer run and at least some of the poor can need to have concern for all this. Therefore, environment policy will have to definitely keep that in mind, the long-term interest. How do we do that? That we can do by drawing upon your pathways to development or approach to development. So, coming back to the question, therefore, are there some approaches which are environmentally benign? Difficult to answer. So, therefore, I rephrase the question. Can you say there are some development strategies which are worse than others from the environmental point of view? Yeah, that may be easier for me to identify. So, let's try and see whether which are the worst. Or can you identify something which are, so what are the pathways that are there, etc. But for us, you need to understand the pathways themselves. Quickly, in 5 minutes, I'll tell you what kind of development strategy that different countries have followed. And here, I'm not talking about just India. I'm talking about this drawn upon development pathways used or approaches to development used by several countries in the world. Usually, we distinguish development approaches to development or development strategies in terms of two aspects. The pace of development, fast, slow. Secondly, in terms of what are the primary engines of growth. For example, the American growth model or development model is also looked at close by to what is called the Fordism, automobile sector. It is automobile sector which was given a lot of prominence right from the beginning. Japan also followed it for some time. And that was the engine of growth. Other sectors, because automobiles have strong backward linkage, all the components and parts will have to be manufactured by several people. Strong forward linkage, because once the automobile is done, then to ride the auto cars, you have to have good infrastructure. And once that is there, then you can connect places and trade will help to bring about development overall. Automobile is what they sort of focused on. And the only difference between them and other countries is they by and large, followed upon private mode of transportation. Automobile more as a private mode of transportation, not in terms of public transport system like railways, etc. British by and large follow the railway system, public mode of transport. Now, subsequently, they build the public transport. So, it is possible that you identify different countries in terms of what are the primary engines of growth and, of course, different pace. So, there are interrelated instrumental dimensions that developing countries they face, but they primary in terms of these two, pace and engine of primary engines of growth. Obviously, every country would like to achieve development at the fastest rate and accordingly choose the primary engines of growth. So, there is a debate in India saying that we have chosen IT sector as an engine of growth in the last 10 years. So that led to a lot of, you know, scientifically, technically skilled manpower immediately finding job. So mushrooming of engineering colleges, fine, more and more demand for it, more and more employment, perfect. Is it going to be environmentally benign? We don't know. What are the adverse effect of it? No, no, it's all, there's no pollution here, but only thing is they demand more and more energy. So if you can correct the source of the method through which you generate energy, it should be solvable. This sort of debate one gets into. So again, as against say iron and steel sector, which we emphasized in 1950s and 60s, or the microelectronic based industries in 1980s, chemical based industries in 1980s, etc. So based on the pathways adopted for development or strategy or approaches to development, it is possible to cluster countries, classify countries, and then put them in different clusters. But here you must understand that there are differences among the, and the among along the dimensions among countries pursuing same development strategy also. We were supposed to have followed the model prepared by Feldman for Russia, former USSR, currently Russia. But we did not blindly follow, we adapted it to suit the local conditions. Therefore, there is a difference in the dimension among countries pursuing the same development strategy. Again, almost all the countries are market based, but the degree of state intervention varies. In Malaysia and Singapore, the government is very active. It may not be the same in Greece and other some of the European countries or African countries. So while it is possible to identify countries and put them in different clusters, the differences in how countries cluster along these dimensions are larger among countries engaged in different development strategy also. In the sense that it is very difficult to say New Zealand followed this strategy, this approach, Singapore followed this approach, and India followed this approach. Also because these countries did not remain static. Their approach to development also did not remain static. Over a period of time, they modified the approach to development. They changed the approach to development, which means they are shifted from one cluster to another. So the first point I'm making is, although you're making a cluster of countries, putting them in different groups, but no country remained in that cluster, one cluster, for too long. They kept changing. So therefore, we are not going to talk about countries, you know, over a period of time, because that will be a separate course in itself. But we are going to talk about in which cluster, when they stayed, they harmed the environment more than another. Okay, when you talk about cluster and approach to development, etc., there are traditionally in the textbook of development economics, they normally identify three approaches. One which says that countries have chosen industrialization as path of development. Because already agriculture exists, primary sector exists, so therefore you want to industrialize, modernize. In contrast, some others say no, we want to first strengthen the agriculture sector, that's our bread and butter, by and large depend on agriculture. And agriculture development will make sure that we are becoming a developed country. Thirdly, there are countries which say no, I want to have always a balanced between agriculture and industry. You may wonder why service is not mentioned here. Because most of the traditional development economics textbooks don't talk about service sector. They only talk about agriculture and industry as two manufacturing sectors, two producing productive sectors, and then balance between them. So one way of classifying them is in terms of this. Another way of classifying the countries is distinguish between two paths. One is inward orientation, closed economy, where you don't want to, you have apprehensions about your trading relationship with other countries in the world. Therefore, you don't want to really embark upon imports and export being influencing your development. Inward orientation, outward orientation. So, inward, you want to be more and more inward, closed economy. You don't want to be affected by what happens in other economies in the world. Whereas, most countries after 1991 have by and large adopted outward orientation. Globalization is outward orientation, where you are linking your economy with the economy of the rest of the world. So one can also classify countries in terms of whether you are closed economy or open economy or inward oriented, outward oriented. So with this introduction, there are theories who try to classify economies in terms of five approaches. Those who say that many countries adopted import substitution. So you are dependent on import today, but you don't want to depend on it perennially or forever. So your approach should be to start those industries who will produce commodities that you are currently importing over a period of time, so that you don't depend on imports anymore. Some others said, no, what we are doing is we want to start export from right from the beginning. So it's basically export-led growth. We will not only produce for ourselves, but also for the export-led growth is very important. See, import substitution takes place mostly in large countries, whereas export-led growth is required in small countries because you have to reap economies of scale. Imagine a country like UAE, United Arab Emirates, or Singapore, small countries. They have to have export-led growth because if they don't export and trade with the rest of the world, their economy will remain very small. Some others said, no, no, what we want to have is a balanced growth of agriculture and industry. Fourth one are countries which are really poor in terms of resource investment, technical know-how, etc. Therefore, they by and large remain as exports of staples, like export of forest, timber and other resources. A lot of people say that a lot of, you know, resources from India used to be exported during the British regime. But fortunately, we did not remain exporters of staples for a long time. But some of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa continue to remain staple exporters. And finally, there are also countries which have adopted what is called agriculture first. And development of agriculture, we will develop the industrialization, so ADLI approach. That also they followed. To quickly tell you, import substitution means your domestic industries are all enjoying a closed market, protected market. And you want to emphasize more and more on heavy industries so that you don't depend on imports of capital goods, iron and steel and others from other countries. So you do export, but basically primary export which you can, just to finance your imports, because you have to import to start with the capital goods and technology. After that, you want to start producing yourself. What happens? With each of this approach, we are going to talk about the impact on environment. Our concern is that we are not, this is not development economics. So in most countries that followed import substitution, who followed it? Several countries in the world at certain stage in life, especially in the initial stages of development. And British government followed it for India between the two world wars. India was an open economy in early 20th century. But after the First World War, the British wanted us to become import substitution economy. And of course, we adopted this after 1950 also, first five-year plan. From second five-year plan till fifth five-year plan, we adopted import substitution only. So did Japan and South Korea, but they all reverted it. They got rid of it in 1960s itself. We pursued it for too long. What happens now, now that we know that so many countries have adopted this, looking at the economic growth rate in those countries during that period is very low. And by and very highly input intensive and capital intensive. As a result, the factor productivity growth are low and your agriculture was neglected or ignored, it remained subsistence. And they were relying more on input intensive commercial agriculture for food production, exports, etc. And the huge disparity in income distribution, and there's a large gap in productivity. It's all bad from the environmental point of view. So most of them had difficulty in adjusting to external shocks and also suffered balance of payment constraints. As a result, they just couldn't care about the environment. They were full of problems in this aspect itself. Now we find among almost all the countries excepting Britain, where for themselves have engaged in import absorption in the early stage of development. But degree, they vary in degree and how long they continue, etc. In Asia, Latin America differences lead to different environmental consequences also. As against some countries followed export-led growth much later in 1960s, East Asia, but they have more labor-intensive patterns of industrialization and higher share of consumer goods manufacturing, achieve higher rate of economic growth, productivity growth and export growth. But what happens here is, they have by and large followed unimodal rather than bimodal patterns of agriculture development. Now what helped them the most in all these countries, early redistributive universal land reforms supplemented by small farm agriculture strategies. So first they implemented land reform so that there is no unequal impact on different size class of agriculture population, and the emphasis was on agriculture investment in extension and technology dissemination, etc. Again, there are different phases of export-led growth. First phase, manufacturing exports, consists of labor-intensive, capital goods, consumer goods, clothing, textile, etc. Second stage, shift from labor-intensive to skill-intensive. Definitely, if you look at it relatively, they have much less environmental consequences than import substitution because the pattern of their plant, etc. As we see it now. There are countries which always believed in balanced growth. They mostly followed in densely populated small economies. They combined the agriculture with industrialization and fostering a high productivity, diversified, high value added agriculture. Denmark and Switzerland are examples of this. Here, agriculture did not protect, they did not protect agriculture from influx of cheap grains overseas. Farmers shifted to specialized high value agriculture like commercial dairying and achieved a high standard of living, shared the benefit of growth more widely. That is why the per capita income levels and living standards here are much better. What happens to the environmental effect of all this? So, better environmental effect than this export-led growth, because it combined environmental conservation technology with non-energy intensive manufacturing industries. The industries that grew in countries, in these countries, are non-energy manufacturing intensive. Taiwan and South Korea also embarked on this for some time, because they implemented land reforms, land to the tiller policy prior to major industrialization. But the problem here is their agriculture technology has been more input intensive rather than resource conservation, which was followed by Denmark and Switzerland. So, therefore, that is how they differed in all this. Fourth is the case of staple export, which is a disaster from the environmental point of view, because they are various poorest of poor economies, and most of them were colonial, under the colonial control. And they export wood logged without proper forest conservation policy, and poor exchange rate also become, giving them less money, and adverse soil and forest conservation practices, although low energy per unit of GDP. So, if you look at the energy consumption, that is low, but then there is no development. And finally, let us look at the ADLI countries, agriculture development led industrialization, where the first step is to increase the productivity of food agriculture, focusing on medium and small farmers. Then the economic linkage of the income expansion provide a stimulus for expansion of mass market for domestic wage good manufacturers. They also formulate appropriate agriculture terms of trade, so try to sync. So, the several countries that follow the step by step, first agriculture, then use the surplus of agriculture for industrialization, etc. Present day developed countries like Canada, France, Germany, Britain, Japan, Sweden and the US all followed this for a long time. Currently, very quietly, Indonesia is trying to adopt this. To a large extent, China and Hungary can also be, you know, ADLI type. Although, as I said earlier, nobody reminds in that thing. So, the environmental impact of this is it reduces energy requirements. However, they have the potential for substantial damage to soils, because they are emphasizing on agriculture development all the time. So, in the absence of specific attention to soil and forest conservation in technology propagated to increase productivity, it can also be harmful for this country. So, they have to be alert with respect to that. So, that is where the difference between some developed countries and other developed countries come back to that. So, therefore, coming back to the question that we asked, is it possible to say that there are some development strategies that are environmentally better than others? Probably we can say yes, but then we have to say definitely this is a cautious yes only. But if you ask me in contrary, are there some that are decidedly worse? I would definitely say yes, especially those who have adopted import substitution for a long time, because these are the days of inter-country linkages and you have to depend on each other. And also those who are following staple export for a long period of time, that can also be really adverse environmental consequences. So, basically what we are trying to therefore understand here is different countries have followed different, have drawn and followed different approaches to development, different pathways to development. As developing countries are still drawing upon pathways to development, there is opportunity for them to learn from the experience of their own economy as well as the economies of the, you know, neighboring or you know, comparable developing countries, and then modify their approach to development and see whether they can address environmental concern in the development strategy itself. It took a long time in for us, 12th five-year plan, of which I was also a member to, you know, draft a part of it. Several of the exercises, after several rounds of discussion, we were able to convince the government to address the environmental concerns into the action development strategy itself. We hope the same will be addressed by Niti Aayog as well, because that is what is important. Because we cannot say we will compromise on development, no way. We need to develop. The per capita income has to go up, there should be all round development of the economy. But at the same time, we will see whether we can adopt certain pathways. As I said earlier, prevention is better than cure. Planning and, you know, implementation of what is planned, these environmentally benign development strategies would be very useful from our point of view also. So, that means there is scope for us to talk about bring in sustainability in the development part. Then how do we operationalize sustainable development in a development perspective. That is what we are going to see in the post tea session. But I will now pause for some time. If there are any quick questions, clarification you want, I am ready to take it up now. Thank you.
SK and Singhagad.
How agricultural development led industrialization affects on current land development bill?
Good question. I have not really thought about land development bill. I am basically looking at it from development economics and development theory point of view. Well, see, actually the problem with land development bill, as people have pointed out, is, you know, when there is a trade-off between agriculture and industry, should we emphasize more on, is he speaking?
Indian agricultures will not be affected for the growth of their lands or crop patterns or etc.
I think most of the people who oppose land development bill have been saying that, you know, industrialization should not happen at the cost of agriculture. Okay, as long as the government can ensure that agriculture, the cultivable land are left for cultivation, and it's only those which are non-cultivable which are being, you know, used for other purposes, etc., it should be fine. So, but the problem comes only when there is, when there is a trade-off, and then you say which land you want to use it for.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning, madam.
I have a question. Mostly in the present scenario, air pollution is caused by mainly industries and the vehicles. The industries have filters like cyclone separators and bag houses like that. But why can't we use the filters used in the automobiles for vehicles? What type of filters used to remove the air pollution?
Well, I guess there are a number of steps we can take to reduce air pollution. Professor Sethi has been talking about it to you, about reducing air pollution. But what I wanted to say is, these countries that adopted automobile sector led development are now facing the brunt of it. Carbon emission are the worst. The highest carbon emission comes from those economies which have led for automobile, you know, led economic development. So, in that sense, we are actually better off. We did not really go in for that. But our automobile development has been by and large because of poor public transport system. So, once you improve on that, we should be able to take care of the air pollution here as well. But air pollution is not simply because of automobile alone in India. Unplanned industrialization, as I said earlier.
Hello, good morning, sir. Sir, I have one question. What is the environmental impact of construction of a dam?
Well, I guess, I know, before I talk about the environmental impact, I would first say, what about the dislocation of people who are living in that area? That's my first worry. Then I talk about environment. That is what I am trying to address it here. But unless you rehabilitate people and then take care of the livelihood requirements, you can't really talk only in terms of environment. Because the environmental impact of constructing a dam is sort of widely established in number of, you know, forums. But, you know, you have to compare the benefits of the dam with respect to the costs of constructing the dam, especially environmental aspect, etc. So, specific, you know, aspects are the use of that particular piece of land itself, I would say, in that area. The area is likely to get inundated by water. So, how are you going to sort of take, you have to relocate the people who are already living there. That is going to be the most important challenge.
Out of five development strategies you have mentioned, which one is good suited for India?
No, see, as I said, that I am not saying these are the only five. I am only saying, took an example of this five. We have also followed, you know, in some sense, each one of it at different points in time. So, I would say staple export before independence, import substitution immediately after independence. Then we are trying to get into agriculture development led industrialization, but very, very briefly, because we thought when the Green Revolution was adopted, we will try to do that. Then immediately the industrial champion said, no, don't get into that. So, we never followed the model of Denmark and Switzerland. That is the only thing that we did not do. And whatever we followed in nuts and bits of it rather than in total. So, I wouldn't say, you know, and I am not here to say that, you know, you choose one among these five. These are all examples to evaluate whether there is a differential impact. That's all. So, the prescription will come in the second part of the lecture where I talk about sustainable development.
Good morning, sir. Yeah. Environmental cost benefit analysis is practiced in India.
Yeah, I think it's essential that we carry out environmental cost benefit analysis in India for every project. It is mandatory now. It's very, very, very required. That's exactly what we're going to say, how we look at it. So, you know, some of these questions you may be able to get a clarity after you make the next presentation, which where I'm saying what is the roadmap, okay, in terms of achieving sustainable development. Then we will maybe spend more time, you know, on the discussion. So, we'll break for tea now and come back at 11.